you say to yourself, at least a week's work, because now you're going to get up and go, meet, 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 and paint that, and then that bit. So again, it's that little extra. I mean, there's nothing in the contract, I bet, if I mean, it doesn't exist, that says we will have loose threads coming out the carpet for another $50. So that's the artist who does things like that just for their own sound, for their delight, basically, because you really are, I think, writing beyond the fact that an artist is some dumb craftsman just slapping colour on something. I mean, most people had no idea of a distinction between an artist and a house painter. So, I mean, even with Michelangelo, quite a long time after, 50 years or so after that, when he tells his picture, his father is quite aristocratic, no money, but, you know, he's a gentleman, but, so, and gentlemen don't work. They certainly don't do manual work. So when Michelangelo told his father he wanted to be a sculptor, the father slapped him silly and then brought in a couple of uncles to help finish the job. And it didn't work, because obviously Michelangelo was quite persistent. But the idea that there is a kind of creative part of art rather than just the sort of menial artisan type of thing, that you sort of upgrade yourself. So I thought that was pretty good. The other thing, again, you've got to trust me on this because it didn't come out well, but look over on the far right-hand side of George's app. Can you see that little thing there? I don't know quite what you're seeing, what I'm seeing. And this is my blurry, fuzzy shot, and I couldn't reshoot it when I went back. But that's what that is. It's a self-portrait, basically. And he's just put himself reflected in the armour, which I think is quite clever. And if you can see it, you see that's his red hat, we saw that in the self-portrait. There's his skinny little legs, that's his hands up there. So that's Jan van Eyck, sort of, I was here, just including himself in the picture. I like that, that's quite a nice thing to do. So that the famous reflection is in fact in this one here that we'll get to in a minute. Because this is my third image. By Van Eyck. I mean, there's quite a few others. He's fairly prolific, but again, as you can imagine, these things are awfully time-consuming. And this is the famous Arnolfini wedding, A-R-N-O-L-F-I-N-I wedding, which is signed and dated, which is helpful and handy, 1434. And it's a little bit bigger than the Rolland picture, even 32 by 24 inches. It's in the National Gallery of London. And they don't have a whole lot of this stuff, but I've already showed you about three, because that self-portrait by Van Eyck is here, that rather nice compact, if it is, of the Madonna and Child in front of the fire screen, that's there. And a couple of portraits I'm going to show you in a bit as well. So this is so famous that, of course, the funny people come along and they do. There's a wonderful South American called Botero who blows everybody up with bicycle pumps and makes them look very fat. And sort of, this is almost a parody of his style, I think. And then, of course, Baba would have to come along. I like the little dog down there. So that's very sacrilegious to do that sort of thing with art. If you find really good things about pictures like this, send them to me, because I collect them. I got so many Mona Lisas, you wouldn't believe. She's probably the biggest target of all. Anyway, what we're looking at here, it's called the Arnolfini wedding, but it might not be either Arnolfini or, and I'm 99% sure it's not a wedding, but we're sort of stuck with the title. It might be Arnolfini. If it is an Arnolfini, this is Giovanni Arnolfini. And that's not a not very Flemish name. In fact, he was Italian. He came from Lucca, which is just outside of Florence. He was a merchant, and we know he was in Bruges off and on from about 1420, and he died there in 1472. So basically, he's an emigrant, an immigrant into Bruges, working there for 50-some years. But what he does is he emphasizes, he underlines the importance of trade between the north and the south. The Medici, who I think I mentioned, they were the principal family of Florence. And they had their main source of income was banking and or intimidation, whichever, like these things, well, they sort of go hand in hand. But they had branch offices all around Europe, and that was, you know, where the offices were. People would work in the north, bring pictures back down south. So it was a terrific way of moving people and art around, exchanging ideas. So if it is Giovanni Arnolfini, and I'll show you why they think it's him in just a minute, his wife was a lady called Giovanna. So he's Giovanni, she's Giovanna. Last name Cenami, C-E-N-A-M-I. And that's another Italian name. Her father was another merchant from Lucca who lived and worked mostly in Paris. So you've got to figure that this chappy and the Mr. Cenami were doing some business, and the daughter was thrown in to seal the deal, because I think more and more the merchant class were imitating the aristocratic folk, the royalty and the rich people who always married for political purposes and or accumulating more land, whatever, or wealth, whatever it happened to be. So anyway, I think Richard II met his second wife was 7 years old when they got married, which can't be too much fun. Anyway, this is as an example of this new kind of internationalism, I guess, of these people who were from one place and worked somewhere else. But what you also have to keep in mind is that, in fact, it was extraordinarily rare for a commoner to have a portrait painted. I mean, I mentioned in the self-portrait of Yamanai, if it is a self-portrait, that was pretty much unique. There are very, very few other examples by other artists at this particular time. Because you just, why would you waste the time and the pain and the effort to create a self-portrait that nobody would want to buy? But the idea was that unless you were a pope or an emperor or some highfalutin person, you weren't worthy of being immortalized anyway. What we'll see after this, I'm going to do a little quick thing on just individual portraits. And what we'll see is that the normal procedure, if you were going to do one at all for the new middle class, was to have separate pictures, one of the husband, one of the wife, separate frames, usually sort of slightly turning towards each other, or I guess if you're having a fight, you can switch them over and have your back to each other. But they were always just sort of head and shoulders, minimal information, none of all the other stuff that's going on here. So I bet if you can get into your time machine, you would find out that, in fact, Yamanai was a friend of these people. And he sat down with them and said, "And look, let's do a portrait, but we're going to make it much more than just a portrait. We're going to do all this symbolic stuff, and it's just going to be amazing." Because you wouldn't do that with just somebody who said, "Look, here's $200, paint my portrait." Because there is as much stuff in here as there is in any religious, strictly religious picture at the time. But this is very sort of what you might call high Van Eyck. The figure's very immobile, nobody's really moving, or there's no emotion or motion somehow. Even though, I mean, there's terrific monumentality, even though the picture itself isn't actually all that big. So the reason we're thinking that this is Giovanni Arnolfini is that, in fact, another portrait by Van Eyck, which is in Berlin, which is a portrait of him. How they know that, I'm not quite sure, to be honest. But, I mean, it's specific enough, that big ugly nose and things, that could well be true. Because there's, as usual, there's sort of a specificity in the man. Whereas with the with his wife, I mean, she's very smoothed out and generalized, and I would think so. Well, he you would recognize, even if he's not wearing his big hat. And I think that's another emblem of success. I mean, not everybody has a hat that big, so that shows power of business, and probably even travel, because that might come from Russia or somewhere, the fur for the hat. But she is very, I don't think you would recognize her, because she's just sort of generalized. It's quite similar. Remember the hat or the headdress that Jan van Eyck's wife wore at that point? You get the two coney things, and then you have this wonderful sort of scalloped edged lace that you drape over the top of it. And also, of course, I mentioned this before, she's not pregnant. Everybody wants this to be a sort of shotgun wedding. It's just the convention of how she's sort of hiking up her skirt in front of her, which sort of bulges her out a little bit. But I did show in the and altarpiece, all this great, the crowds, the hordes of virgin martyrs, and they're all in that sort of exact same pose, this rather nice, elegant, Gothic-esque curve that we saw. And not one of those is pregnant, so I'm pretty sure she isn't either. There's also, I don't think you'd ever accuse this because you have a lot of psychological insight. Again, it's rather remote, rather distant, somehow rather formal. Even the sort of raising of the hand, that's kind of a it's not quite a blessing, but and it's not quite a hello and how are you either. But I think what we get here is, and who knows, because I think part of the appeal of the picture, it's sort of very indefined. There's lots of space for you to make up your own mind about what's going on in here. But clearly something is. But I think, again, the possibility that it's an actual wedding ceremony is rather remote somewhere. But there have been dozens of books and articles written about it. It's one of the sort of targets of scholarship for generations, basically. And nobody's ever really been able to pin the whole thing down. But I'm sure it's not just a happy couple saying hello in their bedroom with their shoes off. There's just too much stuff happening to be accidental anyway. Well, I should also mention that the way that they arrange rooms in houses is not quite like that we have it now with separate rooms for sleeping and eating and sort of watching television. So it could be more sort of the living room that happens to have the bed in it, but it doesn't, it doesn't change things that much. So we look at all the objects, we travel around the picture and we sort of add them up and we try to decide a little bit what's going on. First of all, quite the most extraordinary piece of painting is the chandelier up at the top. Did you all go home and paint candles blowing out with... No, you didn't. So go home after today. Just try and do this. It's the most complex shape. And again, this is a virtuoso performance. He could have taken a fairly nice, straightforward, easy chandelier, but no. So you get all the idea of the light coming in from the window, the complexity of the shapes itself, the reflections, picking up and traveling around the thing. And that's quite amazing in its own right. But also, as you can see, there's one candle burning away. We've seen candles before, which are symbols of divine presence, basically. So even in your bedroom, God's there, so watch it. That's kind of the idea. And you can also see, by the way, the sort of crack down there. That's, again, the different panels of the wood that have slightly pulled apart a bit over 400 or 500 years, whatever it is. So anyway, divine presence, also divine illumination, lighting up the world, that sort of idea. I mentioned that I think the candles were also the symbol of transience, because they burn down and they blow out candles in the wind. And think of Diana's funeral, all that sort of idea. But also you could mark them off and tell the time, but if it's a timer, I don't think you would put it up there where you'd have to climb up on a ladder and, oh, it's 2:30, and come back down again. So I think it's much more symbolic than anything else. Below that, there's the mirror and the glass beads. Now, remember I said last time, because of all the St. Bridget of Sweden, the idea of symbolism of glass, light passing through it without damaging it, equals Mary's purity. So the glass rosary beads, the mirror itself, which in the actual picture is about the size of a loonie. I mean, again, this is where the slides distort things. And around it, you can see the actual sort of mirror part. But around it, starting here, there are, if you think right fast enough, Christ, they're all scenes from Christ's passion before the crucifixion. The agony in the garden, the arrest of Christ, Christ before Pilate, the flagellation, the carrying of the cross, the crucifixion, the deposition, the entombment, Christ in hell, and the resurrection. I mean, that's a hell of a lot of stuff around there, all sort of not much bigger than the heads of pins to have all this stuff going on. So that's pretty good. Over here, just you can just see, that's a thing called an asperge, which can be sort of dually functioning, because it's to do a nice bit of dusting in the bedroom, but also, if you were sprinkling holy water in the church, you might use an asperge and sort of scatter it around that way. Up above the asperge is, I hope you can just see that, it's a figure of St. Margaret. And she's actually you can see a fair bit of pentimenti, that changing of when you paint something over and then you do it slightly differently. But I'm not sure if I can move it. Can you just see that? There's a lady standing there with a halo, and dragon body and wings there. So that's St. Margaret, and a lovely shadow thrown back on the wall.